Hearts and minds for worship as we listen to this morning's prelude.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Shepherd of the Hills United Methodist Church. I'm Gaylene Boyette, one of the pastors here, and it is a joy to be in worship with all of you this morning. If this is your first time with us, welcome. We are so blessed and glad to have you with us. We are a church of open hearts, open minds, and open doors, and we're glad you came through our door. We also want to remind you that you were handed a prayer and presence card as you came in. If you would fill out that information and drop that in the offering plate as it goes around, we would really appreciate it. A lot of you have been here before, we know. Just put your name on it. That will be enough. But if it's your first time, any information you give us to help to know you better, it would be a blessing. Also, if it's your first time with us, we have some pink welcome cards in the pews. If you fill out that information and drop it in the offering plate, we can introduce you later in the service. So thank you for being with us this morning. Let us stand and worship God through singing.
Thank you. Please be seated. And let us be in prayer. Here in this place, God, you welcome all the dreamers, as well as the doubters. Here, the worriers and the wanderers can call you by name. Here in this place, we remember all the ways you have graced us. Here in these moments, we are reminded that you are with us always. Here are gathered those daring enough to step out of comfort into the unknown. Here in this faith space, we will find the courage to cry out, God, save us. Here, O God, we worship you. Amen. Give thanks to the Lord. Call upon God's name and make God's deeds known to all the people. Sing to God. Sing praises to God, to God who dwells on all his wondrous works. Give praise to God's holy name. Let the hearts rejoice of those who are seeking the Lord. Pursue the Lord and God's strength. Seek God's face always. Remember the wondrous works God has done, and all God's marvelous works and the justice God declared. You who are the offspring of Abraham, God's servant, and the children of Jacob, God's chosen ones. When God called for a famine in the land, destroying every source of food, God sent a man ahead of them who was sold as a slave. It was Joseph. Joseph's feet hurt in his shackles. His neck was in an iron collar until what he predicted actually happened, until what the Lord had said proved him true. The king sent for Joseph and set him free. The ruler of many people released him. The king made Joseph master of his house and ruler over everything that he owned to make sure his princes acted according to his will, and to teach wisdom to his advisors. Praise the Lord. A reading from the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 12. I was given a thorn in my body because of the outstanding revelations I've received, so that I wouldn't be conceited. It's a messenger from Satan sent to torment me so that I wouldn't be conceited. I pleaded with the Lord 3 times for it to leave me alone. God said to me, my grace is enough for you, because power is made perfect in weakness. So I'll gladly spend my time bragging about my weaknesses so that Christ's power can rest on me. Therefore, I'm all right with weaknesses, insults, disasters, harassments, and stressful situations for the sake of Christ, because I am weak and then I am strong. Here ends the reading.
Over the summer, we've been taking a special look at the book of Genesis and asking the question, why is it so hard to understand the Old Testament? For several weeks, we've been following the story of Abraham and his family, and we've been listening to some difficult stories. Most recently, of the sons of Jacob and the selling of son Joseph into slavery. However, we've also heard that God never gives up on us and always seeks to bring about goodness in this life, even when we have behaved the worst of ways. Today, we continue the story of Joseph and God's attempt to move Abraham's family from a path of destruction to a path of grace and blessing for themselves and for the world. So, from chapters 39 and 41 of the book of Genesis, with the help of the musical Joseph and the amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, here is the story, Joseph, Age to Perfection.
When Joseph had been taken down to Egypt, Potiphar, Pharaoh's chief officer, the commander of the royal guard, and an Egyptian, purchased him from the Ishmaelites, who had brought him down there. Sometime later, his master's wife became attracted to Joseph and said, "Sleep with me." He refused. One day, when Joseph arrived at the house to do his work, none of the household's men were there. She grabbed his garment, saying, "Lie down with me." But he left his garment in her hands and ran outside. She kept the garment with her until Joseph's master came home, and she told him the same thing. "The Hebrew slave whom you brought to us to ridicule me came to me. But when I raised my voice and screamed, he left his garment with me and ran outside." When Joseph's master heard the things that his wife told him, "This is what your servant did to me," he was incensed. Joseph's master took him and threw him in jail, the place where the king's prisoners were held.
Potiphar was counting shekels in his den below the bedroom when he heard a mighty rumpus clattering above him. Suddenly he knew his riches couldn't buy him what he wanted. Gold would never make him happy if she didn't love him. Living on a mighty roar, Potiphar burst through the door.
Joseph will see you rot in jail. The things you have done are beyond the pale.
Poor Joseph locked up in a cell. Things aren't going well. He locked up in a cell. Locked up in a cell. Locked up in a
close every door to me, hide all the world from me, bar all the windows and shut out the light. Do what you want with me, hate me and laugh at me, darken my daytime and torture my night. If my life were important, I would ask, will I live or die? But I know the answers lie far from this world. Close every door to me, keep those I love from me. Children of Israel are never alone, for I know I shall find my own peace of mind. For I have been promised a land of my own. Just give me a number instead of a name. Just forget all about me and let me decay. I do not matter, I'm only one person. Destroy me completely and throw me away. If my life were important, I would ask, will I live or die? But I know the answers lie far from this world. Close every door to me, keep those I love from me. Children of Israel are never alone, for we know we shall find our own peace of mind. For we have been promised a land of our own.
Thank you.
Pharaoh had two dreams. In the morning, he was disturbed and summoned all of Egypt's religious experts and all of its advisors. Pharaoh described his dreams to them, but they couldn't interpret them for Pharaoh. And then the chief wine steward spoke to Pharaoh. "Today, I just remembered my mistake. Pharaoh was angry with his servants and put me and the chief baker under arrest with the commander of the royal guard. We both dreamed one night. A young Hebrew man, a servant of the commander of the royal guard, was with us. We described our dreams to him, and he interpreted our dreams for us, giving us an interpretation for each dream. His interpretations came true exactly." So Pharaoh summoned Joseph, and they quickly brought him from the dungeon.
Guess what? In his bed, Pharaoh had an uneasy night. He had had a dream that pinned him to his sheets with fright. No one knew the meaning of the dream. What to do, whatever could it mean? Then his butler said,
"I know of a bloke in jail who is hot on dreams, could explain old Pharaoh's tale."
Pharaoh said,
"Go fetch this Joseph man. I need him to help me if you can." The banks of the river, whenever the thugs came out of the Nile, and right behind these fine, healthy animals come seven of the cows, skinny and vile, then the thin cows ate the fat cows, which I thought would do them good, but it didn't make them fatter like I knew a monster supper should. The thin cows were as thin as they'd ever been. This dream has got me baffled, boy Joseph. What does it mean? Now you know that kings ain't stupid, but I don't have a clue. So don't be cruel, Joseph. Help me now, I beg of you. I was standing doing nothing in a field out of town when I saw the beautiful ears of corn. They were ripe, they were golden, but you guessed it, right behind them there were seven other ears that were tattered and torn. Then the bad corn ate the good corn, and they came up from behind them. Yes, they did. But Joseph, here's the punchline. It's really gonna blow your mind. Flip your lid, kid. The bad corn was as bad as it had ever been. This dream has got me all shook up. Treat me nice and tell me what it means. Hey, Joseph, won't you tell old Pharaoh what this crazy dream means? Oh, yeah! Thank you. Thank you very much.
Joseph said to Pharaoh, Pharaoh has actually had one dream. God has announced to Pharaoh what God is about to do. The 7 healthy cows are 7 years, and the 7 healthy ears of grain are 7 years. It's actually one dream. The 7 thin and frail cows climbing up after them are 7 years. The 7 thin ears of grain scorched by the east wind are 7 years of famine. It's just as I told Pharaoh. God has shown Pharaoh what God is about to do. 7 years of great abundance are now coming throughout the entire land of Egypt. And after them, 7 years of famine will appear. And all of the abundance in the land of Egypt will be forgotten. The famine will devastate the land. No one will remember the abundance in the land because the famine that follows will be so very severe. The dream occurred to Pharaoh twice because God is determined to do it, and God will make it happen soon.
Now Pharaoh should find an intelligent, wise man and give him authority over the land of Egypt. Then Pharaoh should appoint administrators over the land and take 1/5 of all the produce of the land of Egypt during the 7 years of abundance. During the good years that are coming, they should collect all such food and store the grain under Pharaoh's control, protecting the food in the cities. This food will be reserved for the 7 years of famine to follow in the land of Egypt, so that the land won't be ravaged by the famine.
This advice seemed wise to Pharaoh and all his servants, and Pharaoh said to his servants, "Can we find a man with more God-given gifts than this one?" And then Pharaoh said to Joseph, "Since God has made all of this known to you, no one is as intelligent and wise as you are. You will be in charge of my kingdom, and all my people will obey your command. Only as the enthroned king will I be greater than you."
This is the word of the Lord. I'd like to read you a quote from Mary Westmacott. And I'm sorry if the language is a little salty at one spot. "It takes a really strong character to say, I have made a complete ass of myself, and laugh about it, and go on to the next thing. The weak have to have something to take hold of. They have to see their mistakes not simply as a failure to cope, but as a definite fault, a tragic sin." I ran across this quote, I was reading her book, The Rose and the Yew Tree, back when I was really still quite young, as a teenager. But I had already come to the point that it made sense to me. There were strong people who were willing to take defeat, take struggles, and move on. Laugh at themselves, if that's what they needed to do. But there were also others, and I had seen so much of it in my high school. There were the kids that wanted to get by doing as little work as possible and making as small an effort as it took to still graduate from high school. And there were those that would complain, "Oh, well, I'm not as smart as you are. I couldn't do that." I mean, everybody seemed to have excuses if they weren't willing to put in the work and make something of their life. Most of us, at some point in our lives, begin to see that there are strong people who can deal with the world and weak ones who can't. Or another way we put it is there are those that grow up and become adults dealing with the world, and there are others that just don't seem to ever grow up. This is called resiliency. And I was so pleased this last February when it was actually one of the topics discussed at the gathering, which is the retreat of the clergy every year, the Desert Southwest Conference, combined with some continuing education. And we were being told about resiliency. And the presenter drew a horizontal line and said, this is the range of problems that we face in our life. So it goes from I broke my fingernail to I broke my finger, sort of a bigger problem, to oh, my battery's dead in my car, or I totaled it. You know, there's a whole range out there. And on the vertical line, she said this is our ability to cope with those things, to be resilient. And she divided each of those lines in two so that we had four quadrants. And up here on this upper right, the people have really extreme problems sometimes, but have really good resiliency. She said, you may never know about their problems. You may never hear from them. But down here on this lower left, people who have small problems but still have no resiliency, no coping ability, you may hear from them all the time. It may be the friend or the family member who seems to be constantly having drama and trouble in their lives, or it may be that annoying person you know who you want to just say, will you deal with it and move on, please? But the great thing that she told me that I had never thought about since I first ran across this quote was that we can all learn how to cope. It is a skill that can be taught, and we can learn. And probably the most famous example is the difference between the parent with the first child and the parent with the fourth. We learn. We calm down. We're able to cope with things. And this came to my mind because as I read this story of Joseph, we left Joseph in dire straits. He'd been sold into slavery, taken off to a foreign land, the land of Egypt. He was many things as a kid, but none of them seemed to be very good, and now he was a slave on top of it all, and yet he seems to do well for himself. Where did he learn that resiliency? How did he learn to cope? Because usually we learn it from our parents, our family of origin, our teacher, hopefully some mentors when we get into the working world, things like that. But he was the spoiled brat son, right? Where would he learn coping skills? But he was also the teased younger brother. Well, once again, where would he learn coping skills? Or maybe it's because he was one of 11 sons at that point in time and ignored by his older brothers that he grew rather independent. Maybe it was just natural resiliency. Maybe it was his intelligence. Whatever it is, he doesn't whine his way through Egypt and complain. And, oh, if you would just write, my father, he's rich, he'd send you the money and buy me back. Instead, he sets to work. He works hard. He uses his ability, his education, for his master Potiphar, and in the end, he's put in charge of the household. He's doing okay for a slave. He's got one of the better situations out there. But then there's Potiphar's wife. And he says no to her. Oh my gosh, where did he learn that? Was his family of that sort of moral standing that he was taught from when he was young? You don't go around sleeping with other people's, you know, wives? Or was it because his brothers betrayed him and sold him into slavery? Knowing how bad betrayal felt, he wasn't willing to betray his master. Or perhaps that it was even the fact that he'd been a tattletale as a kid and he knew there was always somebody listening and watching. Didn't want to get caught. Whatever. He totally turns down Potiphar's wife, which in the end leads to disaster and prison as she manages to use the cloak that he peels out of as proof that he has attempted to rape her. So then we have poor Joseph in prison. His situation has gotten worse. But once again, he seems to survive that. Now, I will give you, he's in like minimum security, you know, white collar crime prison. This is the Pharaoh's prison, you know, and he hangs out with Pharaoh's servants that are sent down there. But there's still the constant threat of death. So he does what he can to make himself useful and to become what we would call a trustee. You know, a prisoner that has certain rights and abilities within the prison. And so he meets these two servants of Pharaoh who have these two dreams, and he interprets their dreams that one will be killed and one will live. And he asks the one that lives, please remember me to Pharaoh. You know, he wants out of there. Even if he's not as oppressed maybe as some prisoners, he's still a prisoner. Help me out. Well, of course, if you just return to Pharaoh's good graces, you may not mention the fact you have this friend in prison. Yeah. And certainly the wine steward does not remember until Pharaoh has the dreams. And none of the wise men in Egypt can interpret the dreams. And that's when the wine steward goes, I know a fella. And this is going to make him look good in Pharaoh's eyes. And so Joseph gets to come before the Pharaoh and interpret the dreams. And not only does he interpret the dreams, but he also tells Pharaoh what God wants him to do with that information. For he proclaims that it is God that sent Pharaoh the dreams, and it is God that gives Joseph the ability to interpret them, and it is God who wants Pharaoh to now use the information to save lives. And so in the end, Pharaoh makes Joseph his right-hand man and frees him. This is an amazing story. We see Joseph go from the favored son, the snotty little brother, the tattletale, all these different things, to a young man who has demonstrated the ability to work hard, intelligence and wisdom, kindness to Pharaoh's servants, and humility as he claims it's all God's doing, not his. Little Joseph seems to have grown up into a fine young man, and Pharaoh recognizes him for it. How did he get there? How did he gain all those abilities? Where did the wisdom come from? You heard it in the song, the first one. Children of Israel are never alone. Because the one thing he had when he left home, when he was sold into slavery, the one thing that was left to him was his faith. Now, I remember leaving home. I'm a PK, preacher's kid. I grew up in the church doing all sorts of things that my parents told me to do. But when I got out on my own, I discovered there was more to it than just church. When times of trial came, I realized I needed help. And I knew where that help came from. But I had to make a choice. I either had to learn to rely on God, faith, trust, discipleship, or I could just sit in a pew and even maybe participate in some Bible studies or a committee or two. There's a difference there. Sitting in a pew doesn't make you a disciple. Learning to rely on God does. Because God will be with you and God will guide you, and you can learn and grow in adversity, and you can become, like Joseph, a fine person, humble, kind, using your abilities to help others. For that is ultimately what God wants. When Joseph sent those dreams, God sent those dreams to Joseph all those years ago, it was not, Joseph, I'm going to make you into this great ruler or something like that. It was because God works through us. And God had a plan for Joseph's life. And because Joseph made the choice to rely on God in all his adversity, in all that he went through slavery and prison and everything, and allow God to lead and guide him to shape him, he became the type of person that was perfect for running this project, for saving the people from the famine, the Egyptians, himself, eventually even his family. We can grow. We can learn from adversity. We can increase our coping skills. But first we have to make the decision that we want to learn and grow, the decision that we are going to put God at the center of our lives, or Christ as our best example, at the center of our lives, and follow that example. And we are going to realize we're going to love God and we're going to love our neighbor, because it's not about us, it's about all of us. That's what Joseph learned. That's what he demonstrated. And that's why he became the perfect one to be right under Pharaoh, in charge of everything, making sure that someday when the famine came, in 7 years basically, that people would not starve to death. We too have that ability. It doesn't matter how weak you feel. It doesn't matter how lonely you are. God is still there for you through all your times of trial, through good times and bad, if you are just willing to make the choice to let God lead you, to let God be the center of your life, to let God teach you what to do next. Joseph is quickly becoming a huge blessing to the world. But it's a skill we can all learn. And it's what God wants from us. So don't worry about whether or not you're able to handle things. God can. Rely on God. Like our story from Paul. Paul could take anything. Harassment, trials and tribulations, prejudice of all sort, as long as he knew he was doing it for God, for Christ. And we can be the same way. If you haven't felt it yet, make that decision and reach out and say, God, I want you to be the center of my life. And I promise you, God will help you grow and learn and will use you in mighty ways. Yes, even if you're a little older and have a few aches and pains, God's still got a plan. So grab hold and let him be your guide. Amen.